everyone, and welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Allison Mass, Chairman of the Investment Banking Division, and I'm excited to be joined here today by Tristan Walker. Tristan is CEO of Walker & Company, which he founded in 2013, with a mission to create health and beauty products for people of color. Tristan has grown the company from one product for men to now dozens of products for both men and women. And in 2018, his company was acquired by Procter & Gamble. So Tristan, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Excited to be here.
So where I want to start today is with how you've led the company through these last few months. It's now been 7 years since you started Walker & Company, and it's probably safe to say that you never anticipated leading through a global pandemic. So what have you learned about your own leadership as you've led your employees through these last few months?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. In fact, you know, I don't think about leading us through one pandemic. In fact, I see myself leading us through two. You know, there's the COVID-19 pandemic, and certainly there's one related to this persistent racism that exists in the country. And, you know, as I think about my own company, we have a company that is overwhelming majority folks of color, disproportionately impacted by both of those pandemics, right? So, you know, when I think about, you know, my leadership throughout, the first thing I think about is an expansion of my capacity for empathy. I've had to expand that capacity in ways that I would have never expected I would have had to, because I have to remember at our core, before I'm a CEO, before they're employees of mine, they are people. They are Black men, women, fathers, sons, daughters, et cetera, right? And this people first leadership is something that I've really had to grow into in an expanded way. Then I've had to learn that there are really three ways to manage through this crisis or these crises. And it's served us really well. The first is this acknowledgement, right? An acknowledgement of the persistent trauma that, you know, our consumers, ourselves have to face and have had to over the past 400 plus years, right? Whether physical or emotional. And that acknowledgement is key before you can start to model the way, right? So that's the second part, modeling the way. This idea of living in your values, this is something that we've talked about since we started the company, courage, inspiration, respect, judgment, wellness, loyalty, they guide every decision that we make, right? So we have a framework by which we can act. And that's the third kind of pillar of our kind of leadership throughout this entire pandemic. How do we inspire action for an audience that's disproportionately impacted by these two things in a way that is authentic? And I've had the great privilege to not only lead our team throughout this, but to have our leadership and the folks within the organization not only respect the need for that action and modeling, but to actually execute in the way that, you know, I would have hoped for even when we started this company.
So we are going to get to navigating issues of racial equity because I want to get your points of view on that. But I first want to talk a little bit about your customers and the macro environment you're operating in. One of the key trends that's been accelerated by this crisis across industries is digitization. And you yourself have said that COVID-19 has created this new normal of digital penetration. So how have you seen that impact your own customers? And what do you see permanently changing about consumer trends as a result of the crisis?
Yeah, I mean, it's weird for us. You know, I have an interesting point of view, not only as CEO of Walker & Company, but it's housed within Procter & Gamble. And I'm on the board of a fast-growing kind of fast casual chain, Shake Shack, and then a kind of, you know, wonderful retailer, Foot Locker. So I have all these kind of disparate, interesting kind of points of view. But as it relates to Walker & Company, we're seeing our highest revenue months ever. We're seeing growth unlike we've ever seen before. And one might say, yeah, like COVID-19 kind of led that on. But I think it's a culmination of 7 years of real focus in our core asset, not only the digitization, but also who our consumers are. You know, when I think about the companies that are leading us into this kind of post-COVID future, I think the ones that survive are the ones that have a respect for three things. First, the demographic shift happening in this country and the cultural influence of folks of color around the world. It's certainly something that we benefited from for the past 7 years. Two, technology and its impact not only on companies themselves, but also what I like to call the unseen or forgotten. And then lastly, this idea of brand, right? I really love great brands, and consumers see themselves authentically with the brands that they support. And throughout kind of these crises, throughout these past few months, whether it be Walker & Company, Procter & Gamble, Shake Shack, Foot Locker, this reliance on staples and brands that we authentically love has helped us persist throughout. I think it's going to help us persist after. And for folks that don't have a respect for those three things, I think they're going to die.
So let's take a step back and talk about your incredible story. You grew up in a tough part of Queens, raised by your older brother and your mother, who worked three jobs, by the way. Your father was tragically killed when you were just 3 years old. Your mother put an enormous focus on your education. You got a full scholarship to Hotchkiss, which you've called your four most transformative years. You went on to graduate from Stony Brook University, and after a brief stint on Wall Street at the height of the financial crisis, went on to Stanford Business School. And that's where you really fell in love with Silicon Valley. So what did you see in the power of technology and the entrepreneurial spirit of the Valley that got you excited to pursue a career in that world as opposed to Wall Street?
Yeah, I saw the money, honestly. When I was growing up, the story goes, I like to say I had one goal in life, and that was to get as wealthy as possible as quickly as possible. I said, I don't want to go back to this experience ever again. And that changed, when we talk about kind of values and stuff. Well, let me kind of talk about up until the point when it did change. So I felt that, there are only a few ways one could really get wealthy. Athletics, entertainment, is decent, but not good enough. Wall Street. So I was a trader on Wall Street and I was awful at it. I was an oil trader around the time Katrina hit. And it was fun, but look, it just wasn't for me. And I felt that there was a better way, but it was only the only way left. And that was entrepreneurship. And the day I came to that realization, I got my GMAT book. And I said, I want to get as far away from Wall Street, the Atlantic Ocean, right, as I can. And there's a school out west called Stanford that was known for entrepreneurship. At the time, I didn't know too much about technology. I thought Silicon Valley was a place where semiconductors got made. I didn't know anything about this new innovation economy. And unfortunately, I got in. And I got in January of 2008. And the thing that I realized when I landed down, I was 24 at the time, that there are the 24-year-olds not only making millions of dollars, but fundamentally changing the world. And I immediately thought, why didn't I know about this place, right? I'm the type who will come in, similar to Hotchkiss, whether it be university or Wall Street, and try to figure it out, right? And had I known about Silicon Valley much earlier, my career path perhaps would have accelerated or would have taken a different kind of road at that fork. But I said, you know what? I'm going to figure this out. These guys are making money. It taught me the real definition of what wealth looked like. We're talking about billions of dollars at this point. And I said, I can compete with these guys. And from there, I got my first internship at Twitter. It was when there were about 20 people at the company during my first and second year, which was a great experience. Then I joined Foursquare as its first employee, and then I was hooked. And at that point, I knew I found the industry or the method of disruption that I was most excited about. And the rest was just hustle. The rest is history, frankly.
So what did you learn about the world of technology and growing a company from your time there at Foursquare?
Yeah. So the interesting thing about Foursquare is that they were based in New York. Most of my experience was out in Silicon Valley, right? And Silicon Valley, particularly entrepreneurs, have this master of the universe kind of mindset. And having Foursquare be founded in New York is really interesting because they were solving a unique problem for the New York use case that could be expanded more broadly. Foursquare could never be built in Silicon Valley. I don't think so. It had to kind of be in New York. And at its core, kind of the founders and the team didn't have that master of the universe kind of mindset. Silicon Valley gets all the money. We're in New York. We want to grow tech here. And we want to, interact with people's lives in a way where tech is not obtrusive to it, right? And it really, Dennis taught me the value of product and user experience and technologies being ancillary to the actual product experience you want to bring to bear. And we're experiencing that now. I think a lot of people talk about the technology industry, but everything is the technology industry right now. right? It is ubiquity right now. So I got an early understanding and crash course around what tech could be for everything in a way that I perhaps wouldn't have gotten, you know, joining a Silicon Valley-based startup that focused on technology. Does that make sense?
Yep.
But that ubiquity told me that there was an opportunity that was way more significant than I would have ever thought coming into Silicon Valley.
So that brings us to founding Walker & Company. And you said that you founded the company for a customer who deserved better. And that customer, of course, included yourself. So how did you come up with the idea for your first product, a single blade razor? And why did you think it would be successful?
I couldn't shave. When I went to Hotchkiss, you know, I started to grow hair on my face. It's probably about 15 at the time. And, you know, you go to the local store, CVS in like Millerton, New York, I forget where it was or something like that. And you get the multi-blade razor and some shave gel. I didn't have a father to teach me how to shave, right? So I had to figure it out myself. I take it back. You know, I shave. I wake up the following morning completely broken out with like razor bumps on my face. And at that point, I wrote off razors forever because I felt it was just the fact that there's this blade on my face. I couldn't explain what was going on. I'm not going to do this again. And at that point, I use what's called a depilatory cream, right? So the equivalent of, you know, a lot of women are familiar with like Nair, right? You put on your face, let it sit for 6 to 8 minutes, and then you wipe it off. It's like the craziest, most disgusting, and least efficacious thing that you can have, right? But that's the thing that I was relegated to. And not only that, the experiences that are embarrassing of walking into a kind of retail aisle that's an ethnic beauty aisle, which is next to the beauty aisle, which never made any sense to me. It just felt like we were treated like second-class citizens in a world where we spend more money on this stuff than anyone else. We're the most culturally influential demographic group in the world, most early adopting kind of demographic group in the world. We deserve better. And, you know, just two quick experiences, which really make obvious why I started this company. Number one, my very first internship on Wall Street, a trader on Wall Street. You know, they have the intern class. They walk you up to the trading floor. You know, you open the doors and traders, you know, you guys are familiar, especially old days, you know, pretty rowdy, type A, you know, get up, they'll kind of test the interns. And I remember one guy getting up and he says, "Hey, you like take that bleep off your face." Right. And I was like, wow. Okay. First of all, this dude is like a jerk and super corny for doing that. But secondly, I remember thinking, what am I going to do? Like, I can't shave, you know? And this idea of my confidence being sapped by having this stuff on my face while I'm applying for jobs and trying to do my good work, like that's problematic for me. So I recall that experience as I was thinking about this idea. But really the most transformative thing for me was going to an Art of Shaving store and asking the sales rep, like what I should use for this condition. And, you know, at that time I realized the Art of Shaving was owned by Procter & Gamble. I didn't know that previous. At the Art of Shaving, you can go and buy a $300 multi-blade razor with a nice handle, which, you know, it happens. And they have all the incentive to sell that to me. And in every Art of Shaving that I had been to at that point, they never did it. They've always taken me to buy off-brand, single-blade, double-edged safety razors, which are made for folks that have curly hair like me. They cut the hair at level with the skin, not beneath, like a lot of multi-blade razors do, right? Which makes your hair grow into your skin, which is disgusting. And then one clean cut, right? So I used it, woke up the following morning, no razor bumps, completely changed my life. And I thought, wow, if this is doing it for me, it can do it for a lot of people that, you know, want to get that interview, that want to have one less thing to worry about on their jobs. You know, this is something that existed over 100 years ago where there's no more patent protection for it anymore. So no one's incentivized to protect it. So we had a really interesting way to get into the thin edge of that wedge a little bit and expand the category for an audience that's been incredibly underserved for 150 years with an authentic story like mine. And it worked.
So I want to pivot to talk about navigating issues of racial equity, as you mentioned early on. And, you know, as you have navigated your career from and your life from Hotchkiss to the Valley, there were and still are not many people who look like you in corporate America. This is something you very much focused on through your foundation, Code 2040. And given your firsthand experience, what do you think needs to happen so that if your children go on to follow in your footsteps, there'll be even more Tristan Walkers they can look up to?
That's a wonderful question. Frankly, it's not up to me. It's up to everybody else. The motivation has to exist in order to make this change happen. I had an interview a couple of weeks ago with Bloomberg TV with Emily Chang, who I absolutely kind of adore. Emily was my very first TV interview ever. This is back in 2010. And you know, Emily, she asked me the exact same question you just did, right? And I said, Emily, do you remember kind of that first interview that we did? And she said, yeah. And I was like, do you remember what we talked about? And she said this exact same thing, right? 10 years ago, and even before, you know, I was really trying to promulgate this message that diversity is good. We all recognize that. We all read the same research that says more diversity leads to more profitable outcomes. You know, it's almost as if we all have a fiduciary duty to our companies to make that happen. And if that's the case and it's not happening, there's no motivation for it, right? There's only so much work that I can do, only so many organizations that I can build, only so many board seats that I can have. But you know, the management of those teams, the moneyed interest who can invest in these companies, actually have to have the motivation. And it's not only motivation to change, but also to have a different kind of experience. And I'll kind of leave you with just one example, which I think is pretty telling. There was an investor that we had spoken with who had invested in Pinterest, right? And you know, we asked the question, you know, why'd you invest in Pinterest, right? And look, I mean, albeit ignorant, but you know, perhaps the right approach. She said, you know, my daughter was using it. She seemed to be like super engaged. I was looking over her shoulder and I knew it was something to do. And I was like, all right, wow, that's an interesting kind of approach to observing user experience and making the investment. But I never had the opportunity of a venture capitalist say, you know what, I have a Black son who's had to experience this issue. So I knew that this was something that's worthy of funding. Now, how could that change? Well, you know, instead of saying it's a bad idea, you know, go to 10 Black folks asking the question. 8 of them would have said this is awful. And let's say you don't know 10 Black folks. That's fine. You know, go to 10 white folks. 4 of them would have said the same thing. And that's all the person had to do before making an implicit or making the wrong decision, as they all made. So that's an example of just motivation and laziness, where we all know what the answer is. It just needs to be done. And we can push that and talk about it and shout about it, but someone has to listen to it and do it.
Yep, very fair. So you're not only a Black executive, but you're also a Black executive who, as you mentioned earlier, runs a company for consumers who have been impacted most by systemic racism in America. So what have you heard from your customers these past few months that you're trying to reflect now in your brand, as well as in part on all of the executives that you get to talk to on a daily basis now?
Yeah. Our consumers expect engagement from us on this stuff. They expect engagement from me on this stuff. Fortunately, I've been very consistent about this. And before, look, I mean, George Floyd wasn't the first, unfortunately. You know, we were talking about this 10 years ago with Emily, nothing's changed. But, you know, continuing to talk the message and be consistent and live in the values, our consumers believe that we will continue to do the right thing. So one of the first things that I tell other executives elsewhere is you can start, but be consistent, right? And show that consistency over the years, right? The other thing that I'd say is, you know, consider this as investment mindset, not donations. I think a lot of corporations, they know the difference. But they don't make a line in the sand, knowing that there has to be an investment made in order to make some of their DEI kind of initiatives work, right? You know, for example, you know, the Board of Foot Locker is wonderful. They have a kind of $200 million initiative over the next 5 or so years where they're going to invest in companies, economic development, et cetera, that fit their core mission as a business, which is exactly, you know, from a governance perspective, it's wonderful for me, right, to see that we have something that still focuses on the core as an investment. But, you know, how does that $200 million become a billion, right? It's not necessarily needs to come back to Foot Locker, but that billion, you know, turns into something else and creates opportunity for others. So motivation, investment mindset, and consistency, frankly, is the solution. And I think why our consumers really appreciate us. And what, just one more thing, the authenticity to your core. So the Foot Locker is an example. When George Floyd happened, one thing that I immediately told our team was, wow, our consumers are people. There's trauma that's dealt with. Let's partner with Headspace, the kind of mental health app, and just give free mental health subscriptions to folks that want it, right? And that went really, really well. Like, we're a personal care brand, and that should be inclusive of one's mental health, something that, again, our people are disproportionately impacted by, but also disproportionately don't use as an opportunity. And that was well-respected, well-served, and further strengthened our relationship with our core consumer.
When it comes to growing diversity, you talk about this goal of proportionality that companies often have, yet you think that's the entirely wrong way to think about it. So why is that?
I think this is the silliest and most castist approach to this stuff. Black folks are 15% of the country, but we're more than 15% of the influence, right? Let's get Black-owned founders having 15% of shelf space. Well, why can't it be 80? If you consider not only purchasing power, cultural influence, early adopting nature, like, let's break this mold a little bit. And this conversation really started with me about 7-8 years ago. We were in a board meeting for Code 2040, and our CEO, who's wonderful, we're like, all right, let's have this idea of proportional representation, right? So 15% of Black leaders in Silicon Valley companies are Black, right? And the same for Latinx, et cetera, right? And we're like, why are we capping that? If Silicon Valley is where the early adoption is, if Silicon Valley kind of chases demographic shifts and folks of color are the majority of the world, right? Why can't there be a case for a significant overindex of folks of color? And whether or not that happens, I think it's important to think about a world where that might be possible. What would you do, right? If this were Facebook and it were built in the year 2040, when you have the kind of majority minority flip, would it be founded Spanish language first or English first?
That's a good question.
Right? Like, a fundamental strategic point, would it be on Android or iPhone, right? So I think by forcing that thinking, you're gonna have very different questions. And you're going to be led into a future that not only deserves to exist, but will. And that goes back to what I said in the beginning of this conversation, demographic shift, technology, and brand. And if you're not focusing on those things, within 20 years, you're going to be gone. It's happened before and likely will happen. And that respect needs to happen in an over-indexed way.
Okay, my last question is for all of those watching who want to follow in your footsteps. What is the best piece of advice that you've ever received?
I'd say don't follow my footsteps. the best advice that I've ever received, which is kind of tangentially related to that, actually came from Tyler Perry, the writer, producer, actor, whatever. And I had the good fortune to, do interviews with him like this in three different cities around the time I left Foursquare, speaking to small businesses. And we were in LA at the time, and during Q&A, there was one small business owner who asked the question. She stood up, she said, Mr. Perry, I go through all these trials and tribulations as a small business entrepreneur, how do you deal with that? And what he said completely changed my life to this day. He said, he realized his potential as an entrepreneur when he understood that the trials you go through and the blessings you receive are the exact same thing. There are lessons not only in the blessings, but also the trials. And, entrepreneurship is this, vicious cycle of good seasons starting and ending, and then bad seasons starting and ending, and then good seasons coming again. And you just have the fortitude to kind of acquire the learnings throughout. And here's a guy who started homeless, living in his car. And Forbes just reported the guy's a billionaire as of a couple weeks ago. And it is a kind of story and a testament to faith, learning, and education. And the reason I said don't follow my footsteps is that we all have different trials. We're all suffering in different ways. We all have different blessings that are all different. And there's a power in my uniqueness that has gotten me to this point. And I don't think anybody else could have started and done what I did because they didn't have my story. So don't shy away from your story. Don't follow in other people's footsteps and respect both the trials and the blessing.
That's great, great advice. Thank you so much, Tristan, for the generosity of the hour you spent with us. It was a fascinating talk. You're really an inspirational leader and founder. So thank you so much, and stay safe and stay healthy.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Hopefully this was productive and useful, but you know, the thing that I'd say is just really believe in your own uniqueness and ask the question and know what your values are, and you know, the rest will work itself out. But I certainly appreciate this time, and thank each of you for sitting through it.
Thanks, Tristan.